Well, here we are, the third day. That's from Genesis. That's from Genesis. That's an evening came and morning came, the third day. And it was good. Well, this is the final day, so it must be very good. Okay. Does it going around? This is a flyer about the latest book, which you've seen examples of, I think. Those of you who were involved in last year's seminar will be receiving a copy. Or 2 years ago, sorry. Those of you who were involved in the community of the believers, you will be receiving a copy in any case. So this morning, Feras is going to introduce for us the question and the texts he's chosen for us to study on the subject of human action within the sovereignty of God. We'll be joined a little bit later by Jack DeJoya. He'll be here for the group discussions on the texts. He had a meeting that was changed this morning. He expected to be with us at the beginning. And then this afternoon we'll have biblical texts, and the introduction will be given by our colleague Veli-Matti, Kärkkäinen. Feras, over to you.
Like a pop star now. Hold it right. Okay. So, in Muslim theological discourse, the language used to tackle the question of free will versus divine predetermination emerges in part from certain Quranic phrases that speak of God's decree and preordainment, specifically al-qada wal-qadar, and particularly in their verbal conjugations, so qaddar Allah or qada Allah. And in part, the language also emerges from the earliest theological debates concerning such questions. Terms such as jabr, tafweel, and ikhtiyar are not Quranic, but they emerge from the sort of polemical context, the intra-Muslim context of theological debates, also in the earliest period. But I think the key word here, just so that a lot of you can follow me as I discuss the idea of free will, which is, I think, the word that sort of defines the debate. The key word is qadar. So for those of you with less sort of Arabic and, you know, knowledge of this area, I think just remember that qadar means free will. It actually doesn't mean that, but that's what it's... So I mean, the history is that the opponent... So the guys were saying, no, there's no such thing as God's qadar, were then called the people of qadar. So inadvertently, they, by this reverse thing... So qadar means free will. Qadariya, qadaris, whenever you hear this thing with qadar, just think of free will. Proponents of free will. Okay, so we can discern that the theological debate over free will and predetermination in the early period took its cue in part from a theologia revelata, a scriptural theology, but that is just as well was furnished by terms which emerged from, as I've said, intra-Muslim religious polemics that addressed urgent political questions. The political context or the background, political background against which theological questions were raised, is usually actually taken for granted by Islamicists, given the religio-political symbiosis that characterized the birth of the Prophet's community, which in turn became the early Muslim polity of 7th century Arabia. Be that as it may, the tendency to explain away early theological concerns as being merely political statements tends to overlook the fact that theology was also very personalist and devotional. So from the time of Islamicists such as Ignaz Goldziher, right up to the time of individuals such as Montgomery Watt, and even I would say Fannes and Michael Cook, have all emphasized the political nature of these theological debates. I mean, with some reason, but sort of an important point I think is missed. So these Islamists point out that the Umayyads, of course, you know, were determinists or predestinarians, while their opponents were Qadaris or advocates of free will. But in fact, there never seems to have been a neat divide with those in political office favoring a predestinarian look, while their opponents were all supporters of free will. That is, the free will to rebel. In fact, such neat divisions, if they ever existed, simply suggested an infinite regress. God could also have preordained that rebels out of free will would replace those in office. So, you know, have this ongoing thing with. So indeed, the political opponents of the Umayyads, this is the first Muslim dynasties and the beginnings of empire, were themselves mostly on the fatalistic side, in fact. So the rebels, were not, in fact, all saying, hey, we have free will, let's, you know, kick the bad guys out of office. They weren't. They were actually quite traditionalist in their stance, and they favored a deterministic somehow. If they're going to fall on one of the sides, it would have been on the side of determinism. So indeed, Kharijites, Murji'ites, and I would argue even the Shia at this point are still quite deterministic in their view, although there's a lot more to be said on the development of Imami theology later on, and this becomes much more complex. The notion that a particular theological position was really just a foil for political aspirations from altogether unjustified, this notion that a particular theological position was really a foil for political aspirations arises from a not altogether unjustified distrust of the historicity of what were considered deviant or heterodox theologies as portrayed by the Muslim heresiographical tradition. So the problem is with the firaqjan, the heresiographies are so schematic that, you know, you read them and you think, well, if any of this is really historical. So Islamists were naturally skeptical about the historicity of these various entries in the heresiographical traditions, because the heresiographers themselves so schematically, as I just said, made use of what was emerging as their own orthodox theology to anathematize, as it were, non-affiliates or members of other traditions. So a typical heresiography was structured around a series of theological topics, such as an entry on the qada wal qadar, as I've said, or the imama, or the vision of God, ru'yat Allah, the sifat of God, God's attributes, but even, you know, Muslim sinners, or what was captured under the title of mu'min dal, and their positions on hell and heaven, and salvation. So that's the structure of typical structure of heresiography was such organized, and so that in precisely so that individuals or sectaries, as they can be known, would be named and shamed, as it were, according to the position that they're said to have held on that particular topic in the tradition. So we find, in fact, that the origin of the idea of free will, Qadar, is associated with a certain Ma'bad al-Juhani, who dies in 699, so let's call it 700, who was executed by an Umayyad governor, notorious Umayyad governor called al-Hajjaj, for his part in an anti-Umayyad rebellion that actually was led by Ibn al-Ash'ath, a very important rebellion that takes place around the same time. In two separate contributions, actually, this is the articles by Suleiman Murad, for those of you who are Islamicists, and Michael Cook, they clarify that this was actually because of his involvement in the revolt and not because of his Qadarism, so not because of his support of the idea of free will, that actually he was eventually executed. Likewise, we have another early example, I'm in the earliest period here, by the way, so I mean, this is also a big question about whether theology was really going on at this stage. I think we should think that it was, actually. But this is a general swing back to a confidence in the sources that, you know, I think is a healthier approach, given, you know, this sort of two decades or 30 years of, you know, thinking, revising, or being more critical about the sources. But it's interesting, you know, that there was a very healthy and, very developed theological, you know, landscape. So likewise, a certain Ghaylan al-Dimashqi died sometime after 723. I'm just using here purely Christian or Gregorian dates, whom the heresiographical tradition associates with the Qadiriyyahs, also executed by the Umayyads. And again, of course, we are told by Islamists, is not a count of his Qadarism, that is a support of free will, but for clashing for the authorities during the reign of one of these Umayyad caliphs, specifically Hisham al-Abdul Malik. So clearly by the time the Muslim heresiographical tradition, this is, you would think, 850 to 1000 was being written, many questions had been actually been settled, or at least Muslim heresiographers had settled on theological positions that reflected their worldviews and what was considered, in quotes, best for their respective communities. In other words, what it was in fact to constitute orthodoxy, yeah, what was healthy for everybody. But I think it's worth emphasizing this social context, the concern for public morality, in many ways, I would say, stunted the potential for further theological development. Or let's say the concern for public order, the rule of law, the legitimacy of the caliphal institution, I mean, government in general. And I would say something like the spiritual health, or this kind of psycho-spiritual health of the what Sajjad calls the great unwashed, the rabble, I mean, the oi polloi, as they say. Certainly for the majoritarian ulama, and this is, I mean, thinking of the Sunni traditions, the al-Hadith, all necessitated a theology that kept individuals clear of the moral anxiety, I think, of particular theological questions and clear of any scandalous reaction on these positions. Because it seemed that armed with the right theology, you could do, in fact, almost anything. You could mount a rebellion, you could suspend the law, or in a particular kind of strain of radical antinomianism, you could then throw out the baby with the bathwater, the baby being the Quran and the bathwater being the caliph and his friends. You know? So, as several strains of ghulat, proto-Shiism, if you like, and pre-Imamism in the formal sense, as well as pre-Fatimid Ismailism, I mean, showed clearly. This is interesting, of course, nowadays, because in the contemporary period, I think I don't know if I understood Shabbir correctly, but certainly this is what I would agree with him, that this lack of theology is perhaps what's interesting. This arrested development now ends up being a problem for morality and ethics, whereas, you know, it was arrested precisely for the reverse concern in the early period. I don't want to suggest, of course, that theology ends with the emergence of the main orthodoxies, whether Sunni or Shia, even though, as Joseph Anessis said in his most recent work, which is a condensed version of his big Theologie und Gesellschaft, said that the Kalam, this is, I quote Fanes, the Kalam phenomena reached its zenith very early. Its most creative period did not occur after it had come of age, but well before, at a time when signs of tedium and paralysis had not yet appeared. So this is Fanes. But in fact, my argument is that the productive theology, productive theology, it's all I could think of last night, from the outset was a devotional impulse. I mean, this is the point I'm trying to make. What the earliest theological treatises show us is that the first real theologians were themselves, in fact, paragons of piety. Al-Hasan al-Basri, a key ascetic figure. Muhammad ibn Hasan al-Hanafiyya, the author of the treatise on Irja, again, are just two examples. I mean, there's several others. I mean, you could even use Ibn Hanbal himself, who, you know, has as many admirers as his school has detractors, is said to have authored the Kitab al-Zuhd. Ibn Hanbal, Kitab al-Zuhd, So, I mean, this link between, theology and devotion or asceticism, asceticism is kind of intensification of a devotion, that's how I understand it, as opposed to just purely in a daily practice. I think it's interesting that Hanbalism is, in fact, a school of theology, not really a school of law. But so far, of course, I've said nothing of substance about the actual sub-theme of the day, so in the last remaining minutes, let me actually address the question. But I think this background this is fundamental, this background, and these are the questions. It's not the question of, you can do it in a very, simple way. You can find out what they said. They said all the positions that you expect them to say. They were proponents of free will, proponents of, of a determinism, people in the middle. Well, what do you expect? So let me just literally run through the early and classical period if I can, and actually make a big jump from medieval to 20th century. So support for both sides of the argument surrounding God's predetermination events and man's free will were naturally sought within the revealed theology, that is, scripture. And it is fair to say that both the advocates of predestination, Jabr, and the proponents of free will could find scriptural basis for their respective views. This seeming dichotomy, to some extent, reflects the Quran's own reiteration of God's absolute sovereignty, at the same time its insistence on man's God-given power to choose his path in life. Sorry about the gender insensitivity, but I'm not, as all the genders here know, I'm not insensitive to gender. So I'm going to keep using his and man and everything like that. His path in life. And so, of course, to reap the reward thereof accordingly. In fact, the whole system of reward and punishment could only be premised on God's essential attribute of justice. So, as Quran says, let he who wishes believe and let he who wishes to otherwise disbelieve. Such a statement conformed in general the spirit of the Quran's, of God's, sorry, admonitions to mankind in the Quran, that is to say, with the idea that man would only be required according to his deeds, and that God does not charge any soul except with what it can bear. This is a paraphrase of a Quranic verse. Indeed, in numerous instances, God assures people that he would never do injustice to them, not even so much as a single date thread, to use the terminology of the Quran, or the speck on a date stone. In fact, God creates the heavens and the earth, says one passage, precisely so that every person will be recompensed according to their deeds. The logical implication of all of this, namely from that God was not unjust and that man would be requited only according to his deeds, was that man was essentially free to choose his actions. That was the famous position adopted by the earliest advocates of rationalist reasoning, the Ahl al-Ra'i in Islam, the Mu'tazila. Indeed, one of the main arguments used by the Mu'tazila to support their view and to refute the view of their mainly Sunni traditionalist opponents, or the Ahl al-Hadith, who insisted, in fact, on emphasizing more divine predestination, because it was safer, I think, was precisely that it was absurd and unjust that God should make promises of reward and threats of punishment to mankind, then charge them with religious obligations if their individual destinies had already been decreed before they were born. It was for this reason that the Mu'tazila labeled such traditionalists mujbira or jabriya, so working with the root of jabr, compelling or forcing somebody, being forced. So this is the reason that the Mu'tazila labeled these their opponents, and was the supporters of Hadith, the traditionalists, as Mujbira or Jabriya, and other proponents of human free will came then to be known as the Qadariya, as I explained at the beginning, illogically. Returning to the Quran, however, it should be also be noted that those who were opposed to human free will and insisted on God's absolute determination of all events could also find support for this view in both scripture and the body of Hadith material. Perhaps somewhat... Actually, let me skip that then. I'll just get to the hadith material because I think it's fascinating. There were many hadiths, in fact, that have suggested that certain key features of an individual's earthly stay were preordained. Precisely his moment of birth, source of sustenance or provision, the risk, his term of life, and his moment, and in fact, probably place of death, as the Quran would have it. So, somewhat problematically, we find in the well-known hadith of the womb, which is by Bukhari here, but we have the Sahih right to my left. The hadith of the womb says that every child, so even more problematically for the consideration of predestination versus every child, while still in his mother's womb, has his fate recorded by an angel as either fortunate, sa'id, or damned, shaqi. To be clear, then, this is just one among many traditions, in fact, that were already circulating in the 2nd, 8th century, as early as that, and suggested a strong tendency towards, or preference, certainly, for predestinarian theology in early Islam. And, of course, Montgomery Watt thinks this is natural enough because, you know, pre-Islamic Arabs were all fatalists, so it's sort of, you know, eventually fatalism on the day, that's not questioning, really. However, the importance of the Qadiri movement lies not in its early political associations, but also its contribution to the formation of the theological school of the Mu'tazila. So the Qadariya, who I spoke about earlier, these rebels, early rebels who were executed, in fact, the Qadariya really stimulate the whole movement that then becomes, so you can think of the proto-Mu'tazila as the Qadariya, some in a way. So the exponents of Qadar can to a certain extent be identified as the proto-Mu'tazila of the early second century, a movement whose beginnings, in fact, can be traced to the circle of students around this famous ascetic who I mentioned, Al-Hasan al-Basri. And this comes, we know that Al-Hasan al-Basri was involved in this. One of our earliest documents in Islamic history is, in fact, this series of epistles written between these early key figures. And one of these epistles is a communication between Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan the Umayyad Caliph. I mean, you know, a towering figure, I think, in Islamic history, but also Al-Hasan al-Basri. So you have the Caliph, this imperial figure in Damascus, communicating with someone in Basra, asking them about theological questions, and in this case, the issue of Qadr. Al-Hasan, in fact, gives the response, so the Caliph asks him, what do you think about this issue of human free will? And Al-Hasan says, well, essentially arguing that the bad deeds of human beings are from themselves, while the good deeds are from God. Gradually, the shift towards man's freedom to do both good and evil, and thus be morally responsible for his behavior, would become complete, primarily as a result of the ideas of later scholars, such as Amr ibn Ubaid, a student of Al-Hasan al-Basri, and Wasil ibn Atta, both of whom would later be adopted by the Mu'tazila, in fact, as founders of their movement in Basra. For the Mu'tazila school, the concept of man's free will, or Qadr, would come to constitute the foundation of one of their five principal tenets, the Usul al-Khamsa, God's justice. Because God is just, he could only punish humans for evil actions which they have performed out of their own free choice. The other principal development, I have time. Yeah. Well, a bit more, no? Because we started. The other principal development in the history of Jabr and Qadr is associated with the famous scholar and eponym of the later theological school, Al-Ash'ari. Ash'ari was, in fact, starts life by being a Mu'tazili, so he has access to the dialectics and the methods of, speculative theology, but he has a turnaround. He sort of converts and becomes a staunch advocate of hadith. So then he uses his dialectical methods to defend pretty much all of the kind of teachings of hadith, or certainly to justify them. And so here we get a development of a kind of, interaction between Sunnism and Mu'tazilism, and producing Ash'arism as a theological school. In his Ibana, Al-Ash'ari makes a crucial distinction with regard to the question of Jabr versus Qadr, so compulsion versus free will, that in fact all acts are created by God, while it is man who acquires them. And I think Professor Kadivar probably mentioned the other day this division to kasb or kisab, acquisition, tafweed, delegation. This was all the language of trying to sort of work one's way through how, the two things could be thought of as gelling together. But I don't think it was satisfactory at all. God has empowered mankind, so tafweed, with the capacity, istita'a, to make that free choice, ikhtiyar, right? So I mean, this is a maturing of the Sunni tradition based upon the language of the Mu'tazila, and trying to accommodate really the enough free choice, but vindicating the heavily predestinarian nature of the scriptural corpus. So in this case, the Quran and the Hadith. I do want to say, if I can find my hand, yep. This is theology by the 10th, 11th century. If we stay with the Sunni tradition, then there's nothing really, I don't think there's anything new said since then. In fact, if we want to get a really nuanced position, we'd have to go to other traditions which are not systematic in that way. So I'm thinking of the Sufi tradition and in some sense, also, of course, Sajjad, you don't like the word mainstream, but I think the majority terms, the mainstream tradition being this kind of demographically bigger tradition, doesn't really say anything original since the 10th century on this question. It's sort of resolved and left there in the creeds. But an interesting modern position, which is probably as good as it's going to get, is I think the position of the the late Shia Marjaf Fadlallah. So I'm just going to read his position on this issue of Qadr. He says this. So he died in just a couple of years ago, well, 5 years ago now. So this is Sayyid Muhammad Hussein Fadlallah, Lebanese Marja, as I said. Qadr is not limited to cosmic phenomena, but also extends to the movement of human existence. This movement issue is very important in his theology, I think. So it extends to the movement of human existence in its entirety. There are established divine laws that govern both the movement of both the individual human and societies from their inception to their demise. Choice is one of the elements contained in these established ways. Ikhtiyar is the word he's using. Belief in God's omnipotent power, Qudra, does not preclude human will, since the meaning of God's omnipotent power is that God defines the movement of existence and designs its conditions, so that choice is part of the measure, given that it is included in the divine way ordained for the movement of existence. So it's sort of inbuilt. I do want to point out that something akin to this kind of modern sensibility, which is actually probably I've heard it echoed, and I mean I've read it in a Western context, but I've also heard it from some colleagues over the last couple of days. The issue is this is approaching the question in a categorical way, right? So you set up the question as one of opposition. I mean, free will or determinism, you sort of make your pick. But I think this was, resolved actually in ways that have not had enough attention, and these surfaced later on in the mystical tradition, the Neoplatonic philosophical tradition, the Shia tradition, and this is the issue about the paradox. So I'm just going to end on this issue because I think it's important. This word paradox has come up a few times in this seminar, but we haven't had the chance to elaborate. Let me tell you a little, just very famous, sort of famous to scholars actually, but not probably very well known. The Prophet sort of referred his companions, Abu Bakr and Umar, who were discussing this hotly, this issue of free will and divine predestination, to a symbolic figure of a mighty angel. This angel is of a highly paradoxical constitution, being half fire and half ice. So the fire neither melts the ice, nor the ice extinguishes the fire. Yet this angel praises its maker for maintaining its existence. I've since learned, I know this hadith from Shahristani, but Sajjad tells me that it's in Al-Kafi, it's already quite early. In the Sunni tradition, the next part of this story is actually what appears in the canonical literature, which is where then, we don't know whether it was a few hours later or a day later, they're still debating the issue of Abu Bakr and Umar, and the Prophet hears them, and because they're shouting, it's a heated debate. And the Prophet catches up, saying, "What are you talking about now?" And they say, we're talking about this Qadr. Qadr captures the entire debate. And he says to them, Umar asks the Prophet, "Are we involved in a matter that's accomplished? Mafrool. Or mafrool min. The Prophet said, "Yes, we are. The matter is already accomplished." And then Umar says, "So what's the point of action?" And the Prophet says, "Oh, Umar, you should act. I mean, just get on with it. Each person is eased, muyassar, to whatever he's been created for." So I think that that's interesting that this issue of paradox, I think, it's not held to be a kind of, I mean, what is paradox, really? I find this fascinating that 7th century sensibilities could be theologically engaged and in fact, theologically satisfied by a paradoxical response. But if we think of a paradox, in fact, as taken to signify, as in this case, two truths, there's a whole tradition of this, and I'm not really qualified to speak, but probably Brandon can speak about that. The idea of a two-way truth, there's a long tradition of this. So we don't have to wait for the modern era of Hegelian dialectics or structuration theory to try and understand how meaning is generated or reality works. I think there's a tradition already quite ancient and but overlooked. I mean, if we think about this paradox as two truths, human beings are a truth, God is a truth, the human condition is truth, but so is the possibility of theosis, as some have said. So held together, in fact, these two are dynamic. They can be understood as complementarities, or as at least as productive contrarieties. But I also want to bring in something much more practical here, which I think is of interest, because the Prophet also instructs his community something very, very categorical about qada and qadar. And this comes in the form of a supplication that Muslims are enjoined to do, which is the Prophet says, nothing wards off or averts the divine decree except dua, supplication. And this is key. I mean, you know, it's not, and here the Prophet doesn't use the word qadar, because qadar is thought of as something that can be changed, but qada is absolutely categorical. Usually when God has a qada, a decree, it's finished. You know, it's decreed. But then we have the Prophet have this, you know, says, you can ward off, you can change things, you can have things changed. But this is not the only thing. I mean, this supplication is central, but, you know, there are other instances in which, of course, at least in the tradition I'm familiar with, there is the dua of Sha'ban, right? You know, the dua of Sha'ban is precisely to have things changed. So on the eve of the 15th of Sha'ban, you know, Muslims have this practice of reading, you know, bits from the Quran, particularly Yasin, and in fact involving the language of the Quran, which asks God to change things, you know, change their lot for the year, change their sustenance for the year, and so on. So I think the relation between petitioning prayer and this whole question is really important. Shall I stop here? Okay. I had a much more epigrammatic ending, but of course these things never work when you.
Good. Thanks so much, Feras. We have a few moments for discussion. Jonathan, and then Najib, Mohsen.
I love beating Najib to the punch on these questions. He's always so eager, but my question, and this is something I don't know if I've, over the years I've come to this understanding, so I wanted to be corrected if I was wrong before I continued along this path, which is in the, it seems like in the Western tradition, there's much more, the issue is much more about choice and knowledge. So God's knowledge of things and the sort of the way we, you know, Americans sit around and fret about free will versus predestination. Whereas in the Islamic tradition, I think, and Dr. Kadivar kind of alluded to this, that issue is sort of shunted aside, and the main topic is the creation of the capacity to act in that creative capacity. Because then becomes, that raises the issue of human being as creating something. Is this a correct understanding? If not, then tell me. If so, then confirm it.
It's not a question for me. It's a wider floor.
Within the Sunni Ash'ari tradition, there's a distinction between Qudra and Ilm as being two separate attributes of God. And so God's knowledge of something doesn't necessarily delimit his power to act or not act upon something, and that they're distinguished in that way. I'm not sure how the Mu'tazilites approach that issue.
Thank you. I like that historian of ideas approach you take. I'm a historian of ideas as well. First of all, just very small comment on paradox. If I read Church Fathers, I definitely find there the logic of paradox. But the term paradox, the technical term we use as far as modern Christian theology is concerned, is a term which came to systematic theology scholarship by Barth from Søren Kierkegaard. So we have to keep in that distinction. In the Church Fathers, we have this idea of speaking apophatically, cataphatically about God, which has paradox logic. But the paradox which we use, that term, today we use it, thank you to Soren Kierkegaard. Let me speak with you about what is more important. You talked about Qadarism and Jabrism, or Jabriya, yeah, Qadariya, Jabriya, and their development, which is very interesting. But you talked about it as I notice scholars of early Muslim thought speak about, as if these things about the question of free will were developed in a sort of hermetically sealed process, as if this is an internal Islamic development. I think as historians of ideas, we know that there is no such thing, really. Ideas develop in interaction with similar arguments that were developed in other groups and who live in the same context. When I read the development of Christian thought in that time, I remember that the question of free will was also a basic question in the 6th and 7th centuries. And it was earlier, first associated with Christology. Something like, and it's very interesting, questions like, was Jesus able to sin? Or was Jesus unable to fall into sin? And then that question turned into that debate in the history of Christian doctrines between monothelite, diathelite. Has Jesus two wills or one? But then there is an interesting development in the writing of Oriental Christians about that issue, which came along with that development in Islam. John of Damascus writes about free will in his book, De Fide Orthodoxa, in relation to human nature, not to Christology. He takes it from the context of the Christological argument and put it into that general human nature. Later on, Theodore Abu Qurra would write a whole book called Maymar fil Hurriya, on free will, where indirectly he would interact with Jabriya and Qadariya. My point is the following. Kalam, or theology, in that area, in that at that time, whether Muslim or Christian, never developed apart from interaction with the other. I see Christian and Muslim theology, or kalam, in that area as two virgins, I'm finishing, as two virgins of one encompassing philosophical and logical context. In other words, to study it historically correctly, we have to treat it as a profoundly inter-religious activity. So I cannot really understand Qadariya, Jabriya, and Islam without putting it in relation with that Christianity and the other way around.
Just quickly, thank you, Najib. You know so much more about this than I do, in fact. But I think that's to be acknowledged. My interest is in more in emphasizing that these issues, you see, that has received treatment in the Islamicist kind of narrative. But I think what hasn't received treatment is that these were theological issues that developed for Muslims theologically, internally. I mean, they were of issue. I mean, there's a sense of a maturing, developed Muslim theology that really spoke to Muslim concerns, as opposed to just sort of, they I don't want to sound flippant, that they bumped into, because a lot of Christians were already kind of developed in that sense theologically. So you're absolutely right, and I think, but this is not the only realm. Theology is not the only realm. I mean, it's everything from architecture to, whatever. So I agree with you. I'm sorry I didn't give it attention, but as I said, my point is more about the internal, that it made sense for Muslims to talk about these things.
Thank you. Mohsen, that's right.
So, thank you. Yes. Thank you, Feras. It was a very informative presentation. You mentioned many good points, historical view, and also some contemporary the scholars. I taught this issue several times in my classes. It's the case of confusion for Muslims and non-Muslims.
Right.
The essence of this subject is problematic. It means that also it's not among the Muslims. As you mentioned, it's paradoxical, because we are speaking about power of human being, power of God, mm. and on each side there are several limitations. Mm. So I think the best starting point for this also, I cannot say it's only under influence, for example, of what the Christian made on that time. Yes, there were some interaction with Christians, we cannot deny it, but it was good to mention what we have in the Quran and our tradition. You mentioned something in tradition, but the Quran is so rich in this case. And each of these groups among the Muslims rely on some verses, not all verses. Mm. It means that they can support their ideas according to some verses. And it's good to categorize or classify these verses of the Quran about human action and God's action, God's will, human will. So we need some classification. And the best starting point is not historical viewpoint, because as some of the colleagues, Najib mentioned, we have some evolution in the history of theology of the Muslims. For Qadariyya and Jabriyya, they did not continue. They were changed to something new. Maybe if we start from the contemporary Islamic theology that we have. So what we have today, as I mentioned in my presentation, so Jabriyya were banned, marginalized. We do not have this group in the contemporary time. But we have different approaches to something between determinism, Jabriyya, and delegation at tafwiz or absolute freedom in between, with among Sunnis and Shiite both. It means they understand that they cannot deny human choice. They cannot deny God's power. So they have different mechanism to reach the common ground in between. And in Arabic, we call it al-ikhtiyar. Mm. And you can translate it to free choice between determinism, al-jabr, and delegation at tafwiz, something between these two. Mm. So among Maturidis and Ash'arites, we have theory of kasb that you mentioned. Among Shiites and philosophers, we have ikhtiyar ul al-amru bayn al-amrayn, something between the station, between delegation and determinism. So for each of these groups, we have some supporter in the Quran, and I mentioned, and maybe in the groups, we can talk about those verses of the Quran for each of these three that you mentioned. So thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I mean, I just want to say that theology, you know, if it's stripped from its connection to, you know, real world, lived tradition, devotional impulses, becomes, I mean, just irrelevant, boring, and sort of doesn't function anymore. And the problem is with representing a kind of proof text approach to theology, where, you know, you just find your verse and you're happy with it. Doesn't tell you much about the kind of indigenous development of theology within Islam, which was heavily devotion and practice based. And this is my point. I mean, my point is that you need devotion devotional animation, let's say, produces theology, creates theology for the individual. And in fact, you know, this is what I understand from the Prophet saying, you know, do this dua, you know, interact, and then you can really get a sense of what it is to be. And the point is to go beyond reason. I mean, this is what a lot of these, you know, early figures were saying, that it is reasonable to go beyond reason, in fact, and necessary. I mean, if you say, the question is, it is a very religious question. In fact, I don't know why non-believers actually discuss this issue. Why is it of an issue of interest? I mean, apart from an academic exercise and like the idea of God, but it's of actually no existential concern unless you're a believer, that you then think, am I free or am I compelled? The question is, do you want to be free? And the answer is a totally irrational answer, no. But it's actually the most reasonable answer.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Thanks for putting up with a slightly shorter
lunch break. I apologize for that, but it's everything has sort of come back slightly because of departures this evening, some departing at 1 a.m., so they have to leave for the airport, so the dinner was brought a little earlier, so here we are at 1:30. Continuing the same topic with our biblical texts, looking at questions of human action within divine sovereignty. Veli-Matti, Kärkkäinen will present the texts and present the. I think you've all had access to his paper. It was sent to you, or a link of it was sent to you by email. So, without further ado.
Thank you. It's a great privilege for me to make a small contribution to our conversation. So I will basically read my text. In order to make my discussion manageable and useful for this particular occasion, I will limit its scope in a significant way. I will not seek to respond to the denial of human freedom by those natural scientists to whom world processes are deterministic to the point of eliminating any true notion of freedom. Nor do I take up the equally strong rejection of human freedom by neuroscientists and philosophers of mind who argue that everything we humans do is caused by our neurons, that is neuroscientific determinism. I have defeated these forms of determinism elsewhere and simply assume here the common sense notion of human freedom. As limited as it may be, it is also so obvious and intuitive that even freedom's deniers, luckily, do not live according to their belief. Finally, I exclude from my considerations the matrix of complicated philosophical and theological issues concerning the meaning and conditions of free will. Let it suffice to clarify the meaning of the term freedom by merely raising the most basic question of whether a person is able to act as one chooses without compulsion, or whether one is able to choose freely. My shorthand response is that I speak of freedom in terms of both freedom from, under compulsion, and freedom for making meaningful choices. My aim here is theological. In keeping with the suggestive thematic questions given for this section, I seek to clarify from the perspective of Christian tradition the following kinds of interrelated themes. What are the implications of the common Christian and Islamic conviction that humans act within a creation that is to a large extent given, and we also act in relationship to the sovereign creator who is even now at work? Or to put it a little bit differently, human freedom, real or illusory? Illusory because we are determined by the creator. Illusory because we exist and act within a complex web of relationships to the rest of creation. This raises another form of the question, namely, in what sense our actions are ours, and in what sense they are God's. In this presentation, I will first highlight the obvious dynamic between divine sovereignty and human initiative, evident in our scriptural traditions, focusing on the Bible. Second, I will briefly explain the way subsequent Christian theological tradition has sought to make sense of it. And finally, I will outline a contemporary way of negotiation. Divine determinism and invitation for human collaboration in scriptural testimonies. The dynamic tension reflected in the questions above is well known in both faith traditions' scriptural testimonies. Probably no one else put it as succinctly and pointedly in Christian scriptures than Apostle Paul. He wrote, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and work for his good pleasure." As much as this and similar passages highlight some kind of synergistic or collaborative effort between God and the human person, on the other side, we can easily find passages that seem to be teaching direct divine determinism which would be interpreted to frustrate any genuine notion of human freedom. Just consider the passage from the same apostle's epistle to the Romans. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who shows mercy. So then he has mercy on whomever he chooses, and he hardens the heart of whomever he chooses. Similarly, the sage of the Proverbs declares, the Lord has made everything for its purpose, even the wicked for the day of trouble. Or the testimony of the prophet Isaiah, who is speaking of Yahweh's work of destruction. Have you not heard that I determined it long ago? I planned from days of old what now I bring to pass, and so forth. These and plenty of other passages undoubtedly lean towards divine determinism. That, however, is not the whole picture. Let me briefly seek to balance and perhaps even further challenge the matter. First, as mentioned, there are clearly scriptural passages which endorse and even invite human initiative. We just looked at Paul's passage from Philippians. Furthermore, countless scriptures command us to pray to God consistently, even stubbornly, without desire to give up. These and many similar passages reveal that even in his sovereignty, the Lord makes his actions in the world contingent, although not ultimately dependent on human initiative, which of course is possibly only when freedom is assumed. Second, divine sovereignty is not that of a despot or a tyrant. The assurance of God's omnipotence and omniscience gives robust confidence to the believers, as is repeated over and over again in the testimonies of the Bible. There's no need to worry about the necessities of life, as God is able and willing to care for us. There's no reason to give up hope when facing the utmost trials or even death, as God helps us in our weaknesses and knows all things and us better than anyone else. Recall also the experience of Joseph, the son of Jacob. Having been forsaken by his brothers and sold as a slave to a foreign land, Joseph testified confidently that even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good. In order to make sense and negotiate this dynamic diversity in the sacred scriptural tradition, theologians of the past and contemporary times have sought to construct some viable ways of explanations. To those we turn next. The problem of human freedom in relation to divine sovereignty and foreknowledge occasioned the classical question by the 5th century opponent of Saint Augustine, named Evodius. He wondered, how come God can have foreknowledge of everything in the future, and yet we do not sin by necessity? Evodius was stuck between a rock and a hard place, because it would be an irreligious and completely insane attack on God's foreknowledge to say that something could happen otherwise than as God foreknew. Certainly Saint Augustine's strong insistence on divine determinism intensified this dilemma. For all those who wish to affirm some kind of libertarian form of human freedom, two key questions emerge, fittingly named the source question and reconciliation question. That is, respectively, the way God obtains knowledge of the future and the possibility of reconciling the divine foreknowledge and free will. Let me rehearse briefly and critically the classic discussion in Christian tradition. I do it very selectively. In many ways, the simplest and most common sense solution to the problem is what can be called, literally, the simple foreknowledge view. Although it has some contemporary advocates, it is more widely present in tradition. A typical example is the Thomistic view, which, building on Aristotelian resources, assumes that because God is a simple being, it means that God's act of understanding must be his essence. Since God's knowledge of everything is simple, it means there is no room for contingency, at least ultimately. God's foreknowledge never changes, and therefore more or less divine determinism must be assumed. The Augustinian Calvinistic view materially represents this ancient tradition. Should one wish to speak of human freedom, compatibilism seems to be the only option. As to how compatibilism is possible, this view does not usually offer any sophisticated explanations. More appealing intellectually has been the medieval master William Ockham's way out. That is, there are some truths about the past that do not share in the necessity generally attributed to such truths, namely, truths about God's past beliefs which are not accidentally necessary. The technical term accidentally necessary simply means that the past is necessary in the sense of being beyond our control, having taken place. Although the Occamist distinction certainly is useful, it seems to me more rhetorical than substantial. In light of the inadequacies and continuing unresolved problems of the views briefly mentioned above, new and novel ways of negotiating divine sovereignty and human freedom emerge in Christian theology. The 16th century Roman Catholic Jesuit theologian Luis de Molina set out to reconcile two claims long thought to be incompatible, namely, that God is the all-knowing governor of the universe and that individual freedom can prevail only in a universe free of absolute determinism. He came up with a novel concept called middle knowledge. It holds that God knows, though he has no control over truth, about how any individual would freely choose to act in any given situation. Given such knowledge and then creating such a world, God can be truly providential while leaving his creatures genuinely free. Molinism goes farther than compatibilism, which merely holds together divine determinism and human freedom without explaining it. Molinism seeks to explain how God knows the contingent future. In order to accomplish that, Molinism distinguishes two more forms of divine knowledge, whereas natural knowledge is the knowledge of necessary truths, and free knowledge encompasses the actual world as it is. Middle knowledge is the knowledge of the counterfactuals of all feasible worlds, that is, what humans might do in any given context. It is best to understand the moments in God's foreknowledge as logical rather than temporal moments. The promise of the Molinist proposal is that it makes it possible to be an incompatibilist about causal determinism and human freedom, but a compatibilist about God's omniscience and such freedom. In other words, the libertarian interpretation of freedom claims that the sum total of God's activity prior to and at the time of our action cannot determine that action if it is free. On the other hand, as mentioned, Molinism has no desire to compromise the omnipotence and omniscience of God. Briefly put, the twin pillars of Molinism are belief in the traditional notion of providence and libertarianism at the same time. Indeed, Molinists go so far as to claim that their view best accounts for the multiplicity of the biblical teaching, although that claim is made by proponents of every other view as well. Some concluding remarks. Space devoted to Molinism indicates that my own sympathies go with that view. Although I do not consider myself technically a Molinist, and although I do not necessarily believe that the dynamic between divine sovereignty and foreknowledge vis-a-vis human freedom can be in any way exhaustively resolved, it seems to me, though, that this view helps us hold in dynamic tension the two biblical convictions present in the scriptures, namely, divine foreknowledge and sovereignty on the one side, and human freedom of will on the other side. I am deeply concerned about any resolution that might suggest compromising the sovereignty of God, his omnipotence and omniscience. I am also deeply bothered by such accounts of divine determinism that appear to make human freedom and consequently responsibility void. Better to aim at humble and modest explanations and be guided by the biblical testimonies, which on the one hand seem to point in differing directions and yet on the other hand, speak of the acts and intentions of the one and the same God, the creator of heaven and earth. Let me put the matter in this way. I take the Molinist proposal as heuristic and suggestive. It seems to me that any credible account of the issue has to begin with the acknowledgement of the necessary but not sufficient role of divine foreknowledge. Foreknowledge is necessary for God's proper governance of the world, including foreseeing the future, but not after Augustinian Calvinist determinism, in which God's foreknowledge secures the future by not only knowing, but also determining his decrees. At the minimum, Molinism goes several steps further than compatibilism because it tries to explain the reconciliation problem, namely between divine foreknowledge and human freedom, even if, as expected, it may not be able to offer a total solution. Something like a Molinist-type explanation is in sync with and funds the foundational biblical conviction of the presence of God in the world through his Spirit. Just consider this one passage from the Old Testament. Where can I go from your Spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. If, as Christians believe and confess, the divine Spirit's universal presence makes possible, permeates, sustains and guides the life of creation to which a relative independence has been given graciously by God, then it means that divine guidance is all-present, all-comprehensive and all-purposeful, without negating the important role of creatures. In such a numerological context, the omniscience of the triune God is understood as the divine omnipresence in creation, and thus no event or process evades it. That omnipresence, rather than curtailing the freedom of creation, constantly makes room for independence and freedom. In Christian understanding, freedom is not something that has to be won from God. Freedom is a gracious gift, a hospitable necessity for creaturely life to exist. As such, it allows for its misuse, the creatures fleeing away from the Creator or setting one's will against God. Rather than fully determining the choices and life of humans, the omniscient triune Creator prepares and determines the creaturely environment for such conditions that make possible certain types of free choices, but at the same time does not determine them, although they are known to God. Even if the human person does not freely choose the ideal option, the Creator's will is not thereby frustrated, or else only strict determinism follows. The triune God honors the choices of the creatures, although those choices never come close to frustrating the eternal divine economy of salvation. That said, once again, we should be reminded of the need to be modest about a constructive proposal with regard to an ancient dilemma. Without being able to solve the problem, perhaps the general framework and some guidelines suggested here may help us better live as responsible persons. Daily immersion in the sacred scriptures in reverent meditation and prayer help us deepen knowledge and spiritual insight, as well as, most importantly, cultivate grateful and humble obedience.
Thanks very much, Veli-Matti. You could maybe give Brandon some lessons on how to be in time with your... He went half a second over and you went under. The floor is open, but I'd just like to underline a couple of things that struck me from what you said. This bringing together of the question of freedom and responsibility. Sometimes we consider them in separately from one another. And I think Feras's paper this morning about the political situation in which that discussion of free will and determinism arose in the Islamic tradition, really it needs to be understood in terms of calling people to moral responsibility, and does to say that one's choices, political choices and other kinds of choices, are somehow determined and therefore one is not obliged to take responsibility for them. That is the dark underside, I think, of the otherwise bright trust in the providence of God. Ezra and Paul.
I just want to thank you very much, and I appreciate quite a few points in your presentation. Especially, I like the connection to modern science, that this is not just a religious issue, but also as science is developing and becoming more widespread, we do have the tendency to think that our actions are determined by our genes and our environment, and there's no speech of free will in the scientific context, simply because it doesn't help predict stuff, and science is interested in predicting, that's fine. But then when they bracket, we think a very deterministic picture emerges. So I appreciate that you noted that. And I feel like this very question of we can't prove free will, but we just need to talk about how it interacts with divine omnipotence is almost exactly how it happens in the Muslim context too, that they, even Ash'aris, who are often misunderstood, they didn't question that you have a free will. They were sure you have a free will, you feel it. If you don't feel it, that's your problem, we can't help you. Ghazali has a story in which he says, if somebody comes to you and says, I have no choice, God is determining everything, he says you should, and this is a hypothetical case, but he said you should spit on his face. And he will say, what are you doing? Tell him, I'm not doing it, you know, on my own accord. God does everything. So there's this, if somebody is going against that basic knowledge, intuitive knowledge of free will, there's no point in discussion. So I thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Veli-Matti. I found that very helpful indeed. If I could just very briefly feed in another biblical case, thinking of the crisis of the exilic age, when with it appearing that how could there be any future since things had fallen apart completely. Thinking of the prophets Jeremiah and Ezekiel offering two very striking images. I mean, one, Jeremiah's new covenant with the law of God written on the heart so that it would be obeyed, and Ezekiel offering the promise of a new heart and a new spirit given by God to the nation. I mean, wonderful images which can lead a way forward, and yet problematic in as much as they appear to undercut human national autonomy. And yet in both those contexts, the assumption is, of course, that right behavior is expected and will follow. So just to throw in those examples, which are just grist to our mill, part of what we're wrestling with.
Thank you very much for your lecture. Just to got it clear, in which tradition is this Molinismus to understand? Is he in a tradition of Thomas to understand? Is God beyond time, or is he coexisting with time?
Somebody else, the Jesuits probably in the room, know more about Molina's view of time. I have elsewhere written on how to think of this topic in relation to time, but I guess Molina would follow the more traditional view, which goes back to all the way to Augustine and even Thomas, which is very cautious about linking God too closely to time. Augustine's main, I'm now talking about Augustine, Augustine's main contribution to theology of time was that time is a created entity. But his problem was that thereby he thought that God exists outside time. So the first I say yes, and to the second I say no.
But I don't have time to explain.
We are in time.
Yes, and can I, both Issa and Paul, very helpful. Just a footnote to what you, Paul, said. Yesterday in our group we were talking about covenant quite a bit. We were explaining to our Muslim friends that a leading biblical category of thinking, particularly in the Old Testament, has to do with covenant. And thereby we were led to the conclusion that a covenant talks about not only about faithfulness of God, but also about the possibility of misuse of freedom. Namely, Israelites ended up in exile, obviously because of they had forsaken the covenant, and yet Yahweh did not forsake his people. So it's a kind of interesting dynamic between you have to pay for your consequences, i.e. responsibility, but thereby God's eternal purposes are not frustrated.
Susan.
I would.
It's on.
Okay, I would like to put a couple more difficult texts on the table to get your reaction to them. You quoted from Romans 9, I will have mercy. Well, you quoted from Exodus, but it's quoted in Romans 9, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, in which Paul goes on to talk about hardening the hearts of whom he will harden. And then this divine providence or divine action extends in very troubling ways, complex ways, into human unbelief as well as belief. And so the whole narrative in Romans 9 through 11 is about not Israel's faithlessness, but Israel's hearts being hardened, akin to the way Pharaoh's heart was hardened, to where you get to the end of it and you have God has shut up all under disobedience that he might have mercy on all. These are very difficult texts, but they seem pertinent, and I notice that you haven't put them into this, and I would love, I'm putting you on the spot, but I would love to hear any thoughts you might have on those, what seem to be very deterministic, I'm not sure that's the right word, but texts that emphasize divine sovereignty to such an extreme degree.
Thank you, Susan, for challenging me, and I can always take refuge in the fact that I'm not a biblical scholar. Let's begin from the Exodus text, and I go back to Exodus chapters 8, 9, and thereby where the Pharaoh, of Pharaoh, it said that God hardened his heart. When we follow the narrative, it becomes obvious that before it is said that God hardened the heart of the king of Egypt, the king himself had already opposed quite a bit of divine purposes. So in one sense, the divine hardening of the heart is sealing and confirmation of what this independent creature, namely King Pharaoh, wanted. And if we jump from there to Romans 9 to 11, I'm also troubled by the whole section, not least because I have a hard time understanding how Paul's reasoning goes there. But when I see the juxtaposing or dynamic relationship between disobedience and mercy, it seems to me that whatever divine determinism there is, it all serves ultimately the graceful and merciful purposes of God. It seems like Paul is trying to tell us that as much as there was a human factor in these affairs, there was also some kind of divine eternal plan, and at the end the good news is that at least the remnant will be saved, and perhaps even the whole people of God. So that's a kind of very elusive answer, and I think we shouldn't try to explain away the dynamic and some kind of lack of clarity there.
Could I pose a question? Well, it's perhaps to you, but also to the philosophers among us, or philosophical theologians. When we speak of divine foreknowledge, as you did, we seem to presume that the future already exists, that we want to say God knows everything, therefore God must know the future. But the question is, does the future actually exist? Is there such a thing as the future? Or is there only the past and the present? And it is no slight on God to say that God does not know the future, because you can still say God knows everything that exists, and God has a desire and a will and a plan for what may exist, but it does not yet exist, so that we don't have to affirm that God knows it, and therefore we're not put in this difficulty of affirming human freedom and God's foreknowledge together, either by an unconvincing compatibilism or by a slippery Jesuitical Molinism.
Before the philosophers in the room are giving the definite answer, let me offer a couple of theological reflections. By first saying, there is one of the current ways of negotiation, which I didn't mention, is called open theism. It's kind of an American product, American and North American. In open theism, somewhat similarly, but not as radically as in process theology, the idea is that that the future is so complex that even God at the moment can't be said to know all the details in the distant future. So they believe in the presence, in the existence of future, but they kind of limit divine omniscience. And I'm not excited of that, nor am I convinced with what contemporary physical sciences are telling me. Those of you who know science know that most all physicists believe in so-called block time, as opposed to flowing time. In the block time understanding, the idea is that past, present, and future are not really real. The whole, what we call time scale, is already there, and it's a matter of, like in a relativity theory, it's a matter of where you are located. As over against that, I think that theologically, at least Abrahamic faiths, we have to be able to argue for the true presence or existence of past, present, and future. And my shorthand answer is that even though it's not good to say what Augustine said, namely that God exists outside time, we have to say that God God is in eternity, and eternity is not like it's not something which is limited by the flow of time, even though I believe that earthly time is kind of past, present, and future. Eternity, where God, so to speak, lives, is the source of time. So it means that in divine perspective, what we think is the future that has not yet appeared is as much a matter of fact than past and the present. But to go into details, I can make reference to one of my writings, but I'm not doing it here.
I'm not a philosopher definitely, but in systematic theology we do definitely tackle this question, as Veli knows much better than me. I haven't done research on this for knowledge myself, but I read something I might share. I read something in Wolfhard Pannenberg actually about the relation of God to future. It seems to me, from my humble reading of him, is he's trying to tell us, and I'll try to explain what I will say now, it might be shocking. God does not need to know the future because God is the future. Now let me explain what he means, as I understood Pannenberg. Now by this, Pannenberg is not talking about the future as a temporal stage in our history. He doesn't want to say God is part of our history as if in this panentheistic term. He's trying to say future theologically means the eschatological future. That state of being, it's no more a temporal state. It's a state of being when God will be all in all for all. So God doesn't need to know that because God is that. So it is that state of being eschatological future that God comes to meet us with in our present. So that's why Tannenberg speaks about coming from the future in that sense. So here what we have in my reading to this attempt at theologizing future, we have an attempt at saying we twist the meaning of future itself. It's no more something we know. Yeah? It's something we become. And then within that new logic, God doesn't need to know it. Because God represents it.
Thank you. Mohsen and Shabbir.
My MA thesis was on time. So time is a measure of the matter. Not, it means that on the physical issues we have time. But in metaphysics, there is no time. So all non-material things, immaterial things, the same as God, angels, or other metaphysical issues, do not need time. When there is no time in metaphysics, it means there is no past, no present, no future. This point one. The second point is about the knowledge of God. As I mentioned in my presentation, knowledge of God is not conceptual knowledge, the same as human knowledge. His knowledge is knowledge by presence. It means everything attains in his presence. It means that the past, present, and future in its futureness attains in the presence of God simultaneously. So future is future for human being. Future is present for God. So we should be careful about using future because of limitation of the knowledge of human being. We need to divide present, past, and future. But for him, everything attends in his presence. Thank you.
Yeah, to put my problem again, we're treating past and present and future as though they're simply three parts of a continuum. And what I was trying to suggest was that future is something different from either of those other things. And simply to say they're all present to God. I think Veli-Matti's made a point about omniscience is equal to omnipresence, which made me think of your paper, you've just underlined there, but our choices are not metaphysical. The choices that we make and the decisions that as they play out in a physical world and hence in time, and that time does not yet exist. Brandon, you've got to die if I don't let you give me the word.
I'm not going to get into this because it's late in the afternoon and I'm tired. But it still doesn't. I mean, the position that you're presenting is a very traditional position. I realize in Islam, and it's a position you find in some ways in Boethius, which was relegated to a footnote, but as Veli-Matti knows, is the origin of a lot of this discussion in the West. But I don't know whether it fully does justice to the idea of, what are the counterfactuals of, the possibility of a human being choosing between any number of different possibilities. And Molinism attempts to respond to this difficulty, whether God's foreknowledge deals with this case of all the different possibilities that I have before me. And it tries to, in a way, answer to what Dan is talking about the instability of the future. But I mean, I think my own thinking about this would be something akin to open theism, although I don't know a huge amount of it. I would want to have a more kenotic solution to this, and to say that God actually purposely and freely blinds himself to the future and to certain human decisions. And in order to give the human being, this is already metaphorical, sort of space to freely make the decision. But again, they're all attempts to try to hold two things, as it were, together through faith. And I think perhaps Feras, with his paradoxical thing, best gets at this difficulty.
I mean, I find myself in sympathy with two possibilities. Does the future exist is a question which is malformed, I think. It's an incoherent question if posed by God, because it assumes that the future refers to a discrete temporal state, and like Mohsen, I suspect that it's not possible for that to happen. In other words, there may be a logical incoherence in that. As far as Brandon's point is concerned, I actually have sympathy with the view that God could voluntarily restrict his own foreknowledge of future events in order to enable his free creatures to exercise their freedom in the present. But that would be a decision of God. In other words, it would ultimately be part of the mysterious will of God, so it's entirely speculative. In fact, it goes into areas of theology. And so for me, that would be the limits of the what the Quran calls the ghaib, something which I'm afraid I cannot speculate on.
Thank you.